So welcome, everyone. My name is Joanne Parsont, again, the Director of Education for the California Film Institute. So thrilled to welcome you back for our Q&A for Song for Cesar with our wonderful guests, Directors Abel Sanchez Jr. and Andres Alegria, and our other special guest, Cesar Chavez's grandson, Andres Chavez. Welcome back to all of you. So thrilled to have you here to have this conversation. I'd like to start off just by asking Abel and Andres, how did you two come together on this project and decide that there was a film to be made here?
Well, we Abel had done a song, created a song called Song for Cesar with Jorge Santana, and recorded it at Fantasy Studios. And a friend of ours, a friend of both Abel and myself, Abel and I didn't know each other. He introduced us with the idea of possibly creating a music video of the song, for the song. We agreed to do it. I agreed to do it. And we created a 6-minute video, which turned into a DVD production that we gave to the Cesar Chavez Foundation, which they used in their educational programs. And, you know, as part of putting the DVD together, we interviewed a couple of other people from the union, and we interviewed Richard Chavez, Cesar's brother, and created extra material for it. And it just all of a sudden became obvious that this was a wealth of material and a potential for something much bigger. At one point, Abel had a conversation, which he should probably share with you, with Dr. Maya Angelou about the project. He showed her the video, and her response was really inspiring. Abel?
Yes, actually, that was, I would say, probably the biggest inspiration to move towards creating a film, a full-fledged documentary, because I sat with Maya, her and I had been friends for quite a few years at this point, and her son invited me, said, you should show my mom this clip, this video you have, 6-minute thing. It's very powerful, and she should see it. And so he invited her when she came to town. She was speaking somewhere, and he invited me over to the house, and I sat with Maya. We put it on the TV and screen, and I sat, and he turned on the film. And I'll never forget to this day, I'll never forget this. I sat with Maya Angelou, and as much as I admire and respect this lady, you know, her, we sat there, and actually, she was watching the film. I wasn't watching the film. I was watching her because I wanted to see her response. And what happened was she was watching, and she started rocking in the chair. And the next thing I saw, a tear come down her cheek. And it gives me chills to this day, to that experience, because at the end of it, she just clapped so hard. And she clapped so hard, she had a big ring on her finger. I'll never forget it. It flew across the room. And I was just like in awe of the response from Maya Angelou, one of my heroes. And next thing she says, what are you doing with this? And at that point, Andres and I had not really decided to do the full documentary because it's quite a task, right? And so I told her the story that, you know, people had suggested we do a documentary and expand. And what happened was, I told her, but, you know, we're probably not. We're fine with this little 6-minute clip that the foundation has used in their education outreach, and we're happy with that. And Maya turned to me and says, no, Abel, you're going to do this documentary. You need to do this. She said, this is not just your song. This is my song. This is the little boy in Oklahoma, the little boy in wherever, all these places she named of underserved people and just people that this film depicts, you know, kind of a less privileged and a struggle of social justice. And so she just pointed and said, and you better do it. And I just promised Maya I will, you know. I was already so enthralled with the family, the Cesar Chavez family and foundation, because of what they do and what Cesar did in that whole movement, that I was kind of like the connecting dot. I said, okay, Maya, I will, I promise you. So I promised her. I talked with Andres, and he's always been right there with us and with the heart of this thing. So we decided, okay, let's go for it. And that's how it began.
I would imagine it's hard to say no to Maya Angelou when she tells you to do something.
Exactly.
Yeah. And I think it's so moving. I mean, it's interesting when the movie, you know, the first, you know, the frame of the movie is her. And, you know, without knowing that backstory, it's just so interesting, you know, to see that connection. And it makes immediate sense when she starts speaking. But it's really great to hear, you know, how she informed and inspired the project. And, but Abel, for you, you know, I mean, Andres, obviously, you know, you've been making films, you know, for a long time, but this was obviously a first for you, Abel. This was, you know, you have a long career as a songwriter and a musician. Was it difficult to make that transition and, or daunting to sort of delve into film as a different art form, or does your music kind of inform that?
You know, for me, because of Andres, because of his expertise and his experience, I just had the music contribution and we started putting our ideas together. And he was very helpful in collaborating with me, asking for input and ideas on the clips as we put them together. And he would ask me, what's maybe the meaning of the song in places or the music? And that's how it kind of developed. So I just kind of followed Andres' lead in the making of the film, actually. And my biggest contribution was the music and that part of it. And then it became more so as we, you know, continued. And he saw that I could visualize, you know, what I could, and was very helpful to me, teaching me. Actually, I've learned quite a bit on this journey as a result of Andres' expertise in filmmaking.
Yeah, I imagine. Great collaboration. So Andres Chavez, switching over to you just for a minute. So can you talk a little about how this film connects to your memory of your grandfather and how you connect to the music of the movement and sort of just what this film means for you?
Yeah, sure. You know, I actually never had the opportunity to meet my tata Cesar. I missed him by just 9 months. So like many of the folks who are going to be watching this film, I'm also learning so much about it. But, you know, the music of the movement was something that was always talked about. I remember being a kid singing De Colores, which is a song that became kind of the anthem of the movement, if you will. And that was kind of my first introduction, I should say, to kind of arts in the movement. And so, you know, I think it's a beautiful story to tell. Andres and Abel did a wonderful job on this film. And I think the reason why I appreciate it the most is that oftentimes when people think about social movements, they think that it's just picket signs and they think it's people shouting and protesting. But movements are so much more than that. It's a collective. It's this beautiful mosaic. And what's being told in Song for Cesar is another piece of that mosaic that created this movement, right? The arts and the culture. And so that's what I appreciate about it, because I think for young people or for people looking to get involved in movements, one thing that I always say is everybody has a contribution to make. And this shows the contribution that musicians and artists made to our movement, right? You know, I find it very inspiring for that reason alone, right? To show that no matter who you are, whatever your skill is, you have a contribution to make. Even if you're a musician, you can help tell the story. And it was really the music of the movement that propelled people, you know, talking with my dad and others who are around them. People always go back to the music of the movement and in the art of the movement. That was really kind of that source of inspiration, because you got to remember that during those times, things were extremely difficult. There was constant conflict. There was always, you know, chaos, if you will. Right. But it was the music and it was the arts that provided that source of inspiration for people just to continue going. Right. And so this, the music and this film really embodies what we call the Si Se Puede attitude. Right. It was just one portion of that Si Se Puede attitude to make sure that people could just continue moving forward and just never give up. And so that's what I think I like most about this film, is that everybody can take a little bit of something away from it.
Yeah, I think also just the whole collaborative spirit of the film, you know, and just what we were talking about as far as, you know, the collaboration between you and Andres and film and music, and that, you know, that there's focus, the main focus is on the music, but that it includes all of the different art forms and you know, the poetry and the painting and the performance and how all of that came together. Can you just talk a little bit about sort of that collaborative spirit and how the movement inspired it and how you sort of wove all those pieces together? Because there was just so much, it was so rich and it was just so much to dig into.
Well, you know, when this was happening, this time period of the 60s, 70s, this was a period of not just struggle and social movements, but also of self-discovery. you know, and particularly within the Chicano movement, of which the farm workers movement was, you know, a crucial and key part as a motivator for developing the Chicano movement. The cultural part of it was integral to the movement itself. So it was social struggle, but it was also self-discovery through the arts, through painting, through music, through poetry and literature. And so it was something that was, when we decided to move forward with the film, it's something that really made total sense. In other words, we were going to tell the story of a social movement through the voices of the artists that participated within it, because they had a direct and unique view of that movement. And, you know, historically also, this goes back to movements, both cultural and social movements throughout Latin America, and actually internationally as well, where in the Mexican Revolution, for instance, there was, as is pointed out in the film, music played an important role, not just in terms of inspiring, but also informing people about the movement. And I think that's the reason we took the direction that we did in the film.
So how do you think the farm workers movement of the 60s and 70s relates to the social justice movements of today? Like, what are the lessons that you hope today's activists can learn from Cesar's work?
You know, for me, I would say it's still very relevant, and we're really glad to tell this story for younger generations of today and future generations, because it's the fiber of this film and the message in there is a lot about doing something, as Andres had pointed out a while ago, doing something with either your art, your talent, or your life, or your education. And I think this film reignites that, or at least permeates that inspiration for people that you can do something about the conditions. Because as we know, we're facing a lot of conditions currently, and even the struggle of the farm workers still continues for that better treatment. And, you know, just to be treated right, you know, treated right in employment, in organizing, so that you would learn how to, you know, improve your conditions. And I think there's still a lot of hard work done on behalf of the Cesar Chavez Foundation, the United Farm Workers Union, which is great. Dolores Huerta, who's very important also and was to this movement. She's doing a lot of works in social justice as well and helping. So that thing continues, and I think it needs to be reignited. So for me, a lot of the thing in making the film became trying to inspire younger generations that they too can also do something, you know, with the conditions that they might not, you know, approve of or need improvement, you know, need help. So it was inspiring. I want to make a point that Jorge Santana was a big part of the initial music, the song, the title song for Cesa. And I was so blessed. We were friends for over 50 years, and God bless him, he's passed now last year. But when we went to La Paz, where Cesar's buried there in the headquarters of Cesar Chavez South Foundation, we had a lot of long discussions about, we realized how important as far as musicians, because this is the music side of it, right? My side of that, how important it is to also inspire young musicians or artists, painters, or theatrical people to do something with that art. They can do something with the art. Because one thing that I'm concerned with is how the education currently has dropped a lot of music and arts in the programs in schools. And so we're hoping that this is part of at least personally reigniting students or people that have that affinity or calling for a musical talent, an artistic talent, whatever it is, that they can do something important with their art or their music. And so that's been probably a big pull for me in doing this, and Jorge and I shared that many many conversations, and we were glad that the story evolved the way it did, depicting that.
You know, and to piggyback off of what Abel had just talked about, and in answering with your question about, you know, what can we learn from the farm worker movement of yesterday as it relates to the struggles of today, you know, my thought always is to say that the fight was never about the lettuce or the grapes. It was always about people. And in that statement, this idea of people was that all people deserve to be treated fairly and with respect. And so at the end of the day, what their fight was for respect. And I think when we look at a lot of the social movements of today and a lot of the issues that we're confronted today, we're still fighting for that basic respect. But my thought that I used to say is that when they respect you, then your working conditions will improve. Then the curbs and gutters and sidewalks will start going up in your neighborhoods. All these things will come along with that, right? So then and now, I think the fight, you know, comes down to this idea of respect, right? And so I think there's so much that we can learn from it. I think the other thing that we learned from the farm worker movement that we learned today was that the farm worker movement was a very diverse movement. It was co-founded by Filipinos and Latinos. Filipinos were actually the first ones who got on strike, and then Latinos joined them. But after that, there was people from all walks of life who contributed to the farm worker movement, whether it was them picking up picket signs, organizing boycotts of grapes on their college campuses, becoming involved through their churches. We look at our farm worker movement, and our first two martyrs were not Mexicans. One was a farm worker, but one was a young Jewish woman, and the other was a young Muslim person from Yemen. These were our first two martyrs of the movement, right? And so I think what it speaks to today too is that our movements can't be exclusive, that they have to be encompassing of the collective, and so that we can all work towards a shared humanity, right? There's no difference between Latino parents and Black parents. You know, at the end of the day, we all want what's best for our kids, right? And we all want what's best for our communities. And so I think that's also what we can learn from the farm worker movement of yesterday and past social movements as it relates to today, right? Is that it's a fight for respect, it's a fight for dignity, freedom, and shared humanity.
And one other point I think that it is important to remember is that leadership is so important in movements. And from the farm workers movement, we see that leadership can come pretty much from anywhere. In other words, the humblest person can take on the leadership in a movement. And I think as is repeated a couple of times within the film, it's important for young people to recognize that they themselves can also achieve important things in social movements. They have it within themselves to provide leadership, which is so important these days.
Yeah, great points. This is also a story and a history of, you know, of immigrants in the United States, and I'm sort of, you know, and obviously in the last several years, you know, it's become more challenging, obviously, you know, for immigrants in a lot of different ways. And, you know, I'm just wondering sort of your feeling of what can be learned from this for how, you know, current immigrants are fighting for that level of respect and dignity and how much has changed, how much has stayed the same, you know, kind of where this fits within today's immigrant struggle.
You know, the story of the farm worker movement, was a story of more defeats than victories. But it was how the farm workers and the movement responded to those defeats that defined them. And similar to the immigration, you know, reform movement of today, they've had times where they've taken two steps forward and they take one step back, two steps forward, one step back, right? But I think looking at that farm worker movement and kind of to what Andres and Abel have touched on is that it spoke to people's resilience, the fact that people never give up, right? And, you know, what we've seen is that that undocumented folks, that dreamers, that other folks have not given up on their fight. And for the first time since the 1980s, there is a very good chance that there's going to be a sweeping immigration bill passed here in the coming months. I think what we can take, you know, I guess the parallels that we can draw is that it's an example of folks who maybe folks who are you know, I'm losing my train of thought here. Folks who have always been oppressed, but standing up for what they believe in and never giving up. And I think what we saw at the farmworker movement was that they simply never gave up, and they were able to achieve what it was that they set out to achieve. Fast forward till today in the immigrant rights movement, I mentioned the two steps forward, the one step back, but you know, folks are very confident that there's going to be real immigration reform coming in the coming weeks. And so it just shows that through hard work and perseverance, things are possible, right? And that it can be done. And so I think those are the two biggest parallels that I paint is that there was always struggle. There was always a little bit of progress met with, you know, a step back. But you just got to keep on going. And when you keep on going, you know, something's going to work out. And we hope to see that here in the coming months with the infrastructure bill that's passing. Part of that includes a pathway to citizenship for TPS recipients, dreamers, and farm workers.
Just to go back a little bit to kind of the making of the film, can you just talk about how you decided who to include in the film? I mean, there's so many amazing musicians and obviously people there, but you know, there were so many people participating, and also it was so sad at the end, you know, obviously so many of them that we've now lost, but you know, kind of how you just, clearly you spent many years putting this all together, you know, and deciding who you wanted to take part.
Well, that was kind of the key. That was that we spent so much time doing it. And, you know, as we went, it became clear who we needed to talk to and how we wanted to expand it to include more than just musicians or more than just painters, et cetera. And the key to all of this is that Abel, as a working musician through those years and since then, he knew all of these people. So he made these contacts and you know, would call me one week and say, okay, Carlos Santana has agreed to do an interview next weekend in Sacramento. Are you ready to do it? And that's how we sort of how we moved forwards.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I'd call him and say, get your car ready, load up the cameras and the lights. We're going to Sacramento. We went to L.A. Well, we went many places like that on the spur of the moment because of availability of actually these people. Their schedules, you know, were pretty tight. And that was, and it kind of evolved by itself as well, too. It was always like, oh, you should talk to so-and-so, or you should hear this song, which I never even thought about Graham Nash as being part of the movement. And somebody told me, one of the fellows in the film that we'd already interviewed, just by Graham Nash, uh-huh. Check it out. I heard the song and I said, wow, I could hear the affinity he had for the movement and farm workers and that. So I just went on a limb and called Graham Nash's people and said, can we use a little piece of the song? One thing led to another. And the next thing you know, Graham Nash was available in Los Angeles because of his song Field Worker. And he tells a story of that in the film. And that's how it evolved as far as the people. Something Andres mentioned, said, you know, the leaders come out of the sand and the field and the rocks of Delano. They don't have to come just out of ivory towers. And that really enlightened for me also, the reason we were making it was because many of the people we want to reach with the film, which are students and, you know, younger generations, that they too can do it no matter their conditions, just like Cesar Chavez did. And that's a prime purpose of this film, too, is to let them know that they can also be leaders and organize like Cesar. And that whole thing was organizing. And Dolores continues that today, too. So there's so many factors that I get excited about when I think about this film and the evolution of being able to be part of it.
How did you work in the recording sessions and decide which songs you wanted to include? And you know, I love just seeing the, you know, sort of the in-studio recording sessions. And I think most of those, if not all, were shot at Fantasy Studios in Berkeley. Is that right?
That's correct. That's right. Yes. Mm-hmm.
That's right. And one of the main reason that we decided to include these is that we recognized that what we were doing with this film, it was essentially the same thing that the artists had done back in the 60s and 70s by participating in the movement and using their art to do it. We essentially were just using our art to enlighten people and to bring this to people as part of the movement, in support of the movement. And Abel has, because of his long practice in recording and producing music, et cetera, at Fantasy Studios, had the access. And, you know, we at one point decided we wanted to, you know, illustrate essentially what this process was, creating art in as part of a movement. And what we came up upon was going into Fantasy Studios and recording a number of songs. And Abel can talk to which songs we did and why we did those. By the way, we did them all in one day. We shot it all in one day.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, we definitely, it was a long, long day and a beautiful day, though, in the end. But the songs, there were a couple that were really important that we learned in the journey. And was Daniel Valdez, does that one, Brown Eyed Children of the Sun. And that's such a moving song and such a message in there. And it was really my hope to do that song, record it with Daniel Valdez himself. And so he agreed, he came up, and that's one of the reasons we did that song. And the other one was by a fellow Joel Raphael, who was gonna be up with us performing this at the screening, which is called El Bracero, which is a beautiful song. You know, he's a fellow that was friends with Graham Nash. He's the one that made that connection. But on his own, he's very, he's a songwriter. And he said, as a musician, it's my job to write about these things. And that's, those are the kind of people and songs and stories that we wanted to depict, you know, so that was how I kind of processed who we were going to finally bring up there. And one of the biggest highlights was bringing up De Colores, those children that sing De Colores in the film. Oh, just, yeah. You know, when I think about it and hear it and see them, it just warms my heart because, yeah, as Andres said, that was the song of the movement. Big song in the movement, you know, in them. So that was beautiful. I mean, all these children were just wonderful in the film. Filming them was wonderful.
Yeah, that was one of my, that was beautiful to see. So we're just about out of time, but along those lines, and I know you've mentioned this, you know, several times over the course of our conversation, but just can you talk, you know, as to what you would like, particularly, you know, young people and students who are watching this to take away from the film, you know, particularly as this is the first kind of official launch of the film with its world premiere, and kind of what you hope the impact will be for them.
I would hope that the young people watching this film will recognize that culture is really important to everything that we do in our lives. And it's really important in social movements. And the young people watching it will recognize that if they have a talent that they'd like to develop and use, whether it's artistic or, you know, technical or whatever, that this is an example of how they can use it to address issues that are important to them in their lives, social issues, emotional issues, family issues, and whatever, and that they can use their talent as a vehicle to express those things and to hopefully move society forwards in dealing with issues that are so apparent to us today.
And for me, I circle back to what I said a little while ago is, I'd like to leave them with the fact that anybody can do some good, you know, in unity and in support, organizing. And what I got from this whole experience and have had from my own experience is that I think Cesar and that whole movement in Bolton is si se puede, the si se puede attitude that Andres just spoke about earlier. That's very powerful. And to know that no matter what strata you're from, you know, financially or education-wise or whatever, that si se puede, you can do something to better the world, for the greater good. And that's really what I'd love to pass on to students and anybody. So thank you.
And Andres, the final word to you.
Yeah, no, echoing their thoughts that history and culture is important, and that anybody can make a difference. It's all, it's within everybody to do so.
Well, thank you all so much for the beautiful film and for your time. It's really just been such a pleasure to talk to all of you. Thank you.
Thank you. Real pleasure. Thank you.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to the 44th Mill Valley Film Festival and our world premiere screening of Song for Cesar. My name is Joanne Parsont. I am the Director of Education for the California Film Institute. So thrilled to be able to bring this film to all of you and to premiere it here at the festival. And even more thrilled to welcome our very special guests who are here with us, the directors Abel Sanchez and Andres Alegria, and our other special guest, Andres Chavez, the grandson of Cesar Chavez. If you guys want to say a quick hello or introduce the film at all, please feel free.
Thank you. I'd like to say hello to everybody and welcome, and we really hope you enjoy the film. Have a great time. Thank you.
Yeah, welcome to all of you. And hope you enjoy the film as much as we enjoyed making it. And we'll be back afterwards to talk about it a little.
Yep, just enjoy the film, everybody. And try not to dance too much, because you're going to be in for a good ride.
It's a good thing you're streaming, because you can dance in your living room and not disturb anyone. So yes, we will be back with all three of our wonderful guests for Q&A at the end for a conversation. So please join us for that. Simply go back to your main film homepage, and you'll find the conversation just below the screen, the window where you're watching this film, and enjoy that conversation as well. Thank you for your time and enjoy the screening.